From Yarm to Yibby, Harrington to Horsley Hill, Swalwell to Silverlink, the North East Footy Breakfast with Rye, Steve and Ted.
Right across the North East, the Red, the Toon and the Cat.
Start of it. Oh, I'm glad you're happy, mate. Is that because you've got Monday out of the way?
I think it's because we got all 3 points on the weekend, Davey.
I'm wearing the next round of the FA Cup, lads. Flying the flag for the North East.
Exactly, Steve. We got an actual winning weekends, mate. You know, increasing that gap on that North Hull team.
Don't worry. His manager thinks it's a local derby to Bealey.
He nailed it to the mast.
He's still new. Sickening how much they keep pushing for it, isn't it? It's gross. I mean, they keep pushing for it over there, and we're just like, happy little, Middlesbrough lads.
Yeah, just, I know.
In the words of Catherine Tate, I'm up of it.
Yeah, it's not, you obviously are, because every time we mention the D word, you bite back, so you are bothered.
Excuse me? Oh, Derby.
And one of us, lads, has got the spicy cough.
Yeah.
The spicy cough. Got that's the lurgy. A beautiful way of putting it, yes. Yeah. I have well and truly got the lurgy, lads.
Teddy boy.
I spent all day yesterday in bed, not in a nice way. Literally just like sort of, I was going to say surrounded by tissue paper, but that's not drawing the right image, is it? It's a just me, the toilet roll, Hollyoaks omnibus. It looks like it's the virus, lads. So I will be going to work with me mask on because we don't have to isolate these days. But yeah, it's horrendous. It's proper man flu, this.
Oh, no.
I'll tell you how bad it is, right? Mrs. Ted gave me sympathy yesterday.
Wow.
Ooh.
Yeah, cooked me a chicken dinner and everything just to try and get us back on my feet.
I'd have put the order in immediately.
Sorry, mate. He wanted sympathy in our WhatsApp group that we don't talk about as well. You see that, Stevie? He wants sympathy in there as well, mate.
Yeah, well, I never comment in that group, so very rarely.
Apart from putting your quiz answers in, that's about
pass,
it.
Pass, just in case there's
rest assured, Steve. Rest assured, there's no quiz today, mate. It's just the old classic. We've got what the fact for you today, mate.
Are you worried?
I do enjoy that.
All right, that's good. Sorry, mate. Am I well enough to do it?
Yeah.
I'll soldier on. I'm a trooper. You know, we don't cry off like Middlesbrough do and end up getting docked 3 points because we kind of turn up for a game at Blackburn. I'll crack on through, mate. Don't worry about me. I'm a little soldier, like, right?
He's not that ill, is he? He's not that ill that he can't come up with the barbs.
No.
I'm just delirious on paracetamol, I think. But anyway, yes, we've got a lot to get through. Yes. Some would argue, yes, probably. But lots to get through, lads. Obviously, we've got the FA Cup game that we watched Saturday, with the Geordies. Nice draw you got there, Steve, as well. Obviously, there's somebody trying to look after you and make sure you go far this time.
Another away draw, though, lads.
That's true, mate. But you might make it onto, is it Amazon or is it Apple TV that does the Wrexham documentary?
Yeah, depends.
Wrexham, obviously, see off Blackburn. You've got the Deadpool derby, haven't you? Which is, that's going to be nice one, that, like.
It'll be Blackburn. Sunderland. It always is.
I think so, mate. It's a weird place to go, Ewood Park, though. You never know which Blackburn's going to turn up. So that'll be an interesting one, without a doubt. Potential banana skin. But yeah, very decent performance. I thought Fulham actually played rather well, but Newcastle, obviously, the better at taking their chances, let's say. Sunderland, obviously, impressive win, solid win. Might still take a bit of time to win the fans over mine, but all the same, we got after that. Borough will... we'll move on. Klopp,
he's
obviously,
setting
the
himself
biggest
up,
news,
isn't
lads.
He? He's setting himself up for the weekend. The scaffold has already been erected for the Sunderland defeat. Yep, indeed.
Stonkies. Yes. Yeah. Oh, really? I'm setting it up for the weekend.
And then he puts money so he's proud there. In there. I love it.
Honestly, yesterday, I'm relatively new to this whole Twitter lark. And Rye happened to tag me in something yesterday.
Oh, I threw you under.
Did you throw him under
Didn't
the bus?
You just.
Oh, big time.
Mate.
Tell more.
He opened Pandora's box and basically shoved me in. And then
she wasn't happy with that.
Yeah. She was not. She was certainly not. I might have to go to HR. Yesterday, Rye just tagged me in something. Oh, yeah. Rye tagged me in something yesterday about Michael Beale saying, you know, next up we've got the derby against Middlesbrough. And of course, as soon as he said that, my head was already in my hands. But Rye decided to tag me in that little video clip on Twitter. And basically that just opened the floodgates for all these little smoggy mates to come crawling out from under their rocks and start taking pot shots at me. I'm like,
get in.
What? I haven't even opened my mouth this time. So I had to defend my honour. I think I did refer to Middlesbrough as North Hull to one Middlesbrough fan. I may as well have been from Hull. Then he was trying to explain the reason that we're a lot closer to Middlesbrough than we are to Hull, because obviously he didn't get the sarcasm in that. And to be honest, with some of the Middlesbrough fans that were commenting, I'd just neither had the patience or the crayons to explain it all. But it was good crack all the same. It was good crack all the same. Other stuff, obviously, we're going to get through Klopp. That's the biggest news. I mean, from Friday, crazy. That was a real shock, that one. Also, I watched the Liverpool game yesterday. Former Sunderland Academy graduate James McConnell.
Saw that.
Absolutely fantastic game he had as well. On the brinks of being man of the match for me. I thought he was excellent. But, yeah, we'll have a little look at to see. Like, that was Madrox. That was Stuart Donald and that lot who sold him as a 15-year-old, which is very, very annoying. Fat Club. That's going well, Dave. We haven't seen your way in yet, mate. I think we need to get that on.
I've got the picture from this morning. I was a bit late out of the house, so I haven't had a chance. I'll turn it around now, mate, and send it in to you.
All right. What else? Crowd trouble. Obviously, the crowd trouble that marred the West Brom.
That was ridiculous.
That's
crazy.
That's like a hark back to the bad old days. That was absolutely awful. And obviously, we're into the last week of the transfer window as well, lads, so we're going to have some transfer talk. There's lots of stuff going on at Sunderland in terms of potential incomings and outgoings. And obviously, I'm sure they'll be the same for Newcastle and Middlesbrough as well, so I'll give you lads a chance to crack on through that. There's probably not enough time to get through it all, but hey-ho, should we start with some club headlines?
Well, mate, I mean, we've finished the show now. You were that long explaining what we were going to talk about, so...
I can't breathe. No, I'm literally struggling to breathe.
Daz is up next with his nonsense. Good morning, everyone.
Smoggies and proud. Borough News.
Good morning, Borough fans. Not to get all farmy, but a weekend with no football is like having a cow that produces no milk, a pig that is too skinny for bacon, and a chicken that lays no eggs. In the biggest news to come out of this weekend of football, new Sunderland manager has confirmed that this weekend's tie against Borough is a local derby. In another push to make it a derby, Bill was saying his team would be ready to go. Strange to see how much Sunderland want it to be a derby, am I right, Borough fans? The transfer deadline day for January is fast approaching, and the big story will be whether Borough remain onto Morgan Rogers or not. The former Man City youngster signed for Borough in the summer for a deal worth £1 million. However, it has now been revealed that was also included hefty sell-on margins by Man City. There's now been rumoured that Villa have submitted a third and final bid of £15 million, including add-ons. If true, and Borough do sell, they have managed to gain £14 million in the space of 6 months. Crazy. And finally, Lucas Engel has said playing under insanely talented coach Michael Carrick has been incredible. The new left back has found form of late and slotted into the heart of the way Michael likes to play out from the back. Engel said to Danish TV, he has experienced a lot and he has an impressive CV. He is also a player I watched on television when I was growing up, so to be under him is incredible. He is a role model for many when he has played at the level he has. He is an insanely talented coach. My friends and family can be starstruck on my behalf, and I also have some friends who are Manchester United fans, and they are starstruck all about it. Well done, Engel. Well done. We're all starstruck, mate. That's your Borough headlines. No football on the weekend. A cow that produces no milk. Good morning.
Magpies and Proud. Mags News.
Goals from Sean Longstaff and Dan Byrne proved enough to send Newcastle United into the fifth round of the FA Cup on Saturday night. And Sunday's draw handed Eddie Howe's team a third successive away tie against either Blackburn Rovers or Wrexham, who play tonight. and were Rovers, managed by former Magpie John Dahl Thomason, to beat Wrexham, that would mean that no less than four of our last 10 fifth round ties would have been in opposition to Blackburn Rovers. Speculation on outgoing transfers continues to circulate in the media, and when asked about Miggy Almiron's absence post-match, Eddie Howe failed to calm Newcastle fans' nerves. He said he was ill, genuinely ill. Future, I want him to stay. Miggy to leave next week, it's difficult. I'm not in hourly contact with what's going on. There's a possibility that someone could leave. Newcastle's under 21 suffered another defeat on Sunday, beaten by Blackburn Rovers in a Premier League 2 fixture staged at the Lancashire FA HQ in Leyland. A goal from Charlie Weston in the 20th minute of the first half separated the sides at half time, only for United's Josh Scott to equalise with 20 minutes remaining. Rovers then won it when substitute Junior Nangu headed a corner past United keeper Reece Byrne in the 86th minute. And Friday saw the latest Premier League fixture alterations for live TV announced, with only one round of games messed around with, the first weekend in March. And Newcastle's home meeting with Wolves wasn't selected for live coverage, meaning it stays as a good old-fashioned 3 o'clock kick-off on Saturday, March the 2nd. That's your Newcastle headlines on Monday morning.
Mackems and Proud. Black Cats News.
Good morning, Sunderland fans. Arsenal's Charles Sago Jr. is in talks with Sunderland over a proposed loan move ahead of the closure of the January transfer window this week, according to online and mainstream sources. The Gunners' promising winger has caught the attention of several clubs, but it's understood that it's the Black Cats who are pressing ahead for this signature. The 19-year-old has drawn comparisons to Arsenal's star Bukayo Saka, who is also a right winger and a product of the Hale End Academy. One winger that looks set to stay, however, is Jack Clarke, despite Sunderland rejecting an initial offer between £14 and £16 million from Lazio, with the club insisting the 23-year-old winger is not for sale. It's thought that Sunderland will wait and see the season out and list the higher offers in the summer, although indications are that if Sunderland were to gain promotion this term, Clarke may extend his tenure. And finally, Michael Beale responded to questions regarding Alex Pritchard after Sunderland confirmed he had demanded to leave the club this month, just an hour before kick-off on Saturday. Alex Pritchard previously looked set to be forced out the door by Sunderland last summer, but ended up remaining at the stadium alike to fight for his place. Speaking to the Chronicle Live right after the Saturday's 3-1 win over Stoke City, the Sunderland boss said, "It's been ongoing, to be honest, not just the last 24 hours. He's a boy who's coming up to the end of his contract, and he's been offered one. I think mentally it has got a bit much for him. Let's keep the focus on the players who played today." They are your Sunderland headlines.
On DAB Radio, online and smart speakers.
The Tune Black Cat and the Red.
Jeez, that's a new beat jingle, isn't it? That's
yeah, it's another swanky one, that, isn't it?
Yeah, that's got me. Wow.
Lads. I'm disappointed in the fact that you're surprised that we can swank.
No, that was. Yeah.
Sorry?
That even
involves tissues.
Only with Ted and his virus.
Don't make us laugh, honestly, because I really can't breathe. Anyway, let's make a start anyway. Steve, I actually enjoyed the game against Fulham, mate. A proper decent cup tie, I thought. Obviously flying the Saudi flag as well in that lovely third kit. But
lovely.
Nice draw at the end of it, obviously. Granted, you're going to be away from home again. Good win. Solid outfit, Fulham, as well, but maybe a little bit of luck with the first goal, but all in all, mate, you took your chances, and Fulham didn't, despite the pressure that you put under. Is that about an accurate description, do you think?
I think it stops Fulham bleating on about, well, we would have beaten them if we didn't get a man sent off at St James's Park. I think we're a bit of a bogey team for Fulham, to be honest. I think that we weren't at full strength. We weren't certainly at the races as far as a performance was concerned. I think we looked rusty is probably the best description about Newcastle. First half, Newcastle didn't play well. I think the second half, we did turn it on, and looked a lot better. But I think on the balance of play, Newcastle deserved it. I would disagree with the first goal. I think, you know, I think probably most people who were listening to the commentary in England would have been, it was like a Derren Brown kind of, you know, subliminal mind training by Lee Dixon, trying to convert people into believing that, you know, that there was a handball somewhere. Bruno quite clearly had his hands down by his body and turned with his natural body momentum. The ball clipped the top of his arm and fell nicely for Longstaff to put the ball in the back of the net. It wasn't a handball. That isn't a handball. It was never a handball before the rules were changed, and it wasn't a handball on Saturday. So I think Lee Dixon should never work on television commentary for Newcastle games again. I think he's biased. I think his bias was so obvious that he even referred to it during the commentary that there'd been less than complimentary about Newcastle. What is that all about? Wow. Absolutely disgusting, disgraceful, and for me, Lee Dixon, hang your head in shame, because it was the most biased commentary I've ever heard. And you know,
wow.
It's the reason I prefer to go to the games and not watch TV games. It's, you know, I couldn't get to Fulham; it was an absolute nightmare for me. You know, trains can't. You know, you know, obviously trains, etc. At that time, don't operate. So anyone who went down, credit to you guys. You would have got back at you know 4, 5, 6 in the morning, and some people had to have an overnight stay. And I just couldn't. I couldn't do that this weekend. But great second half performance. I think ultimately the goals. You know, obviously Longstaff and Byrne. It was good to see the two local lads get amongst the goals. And I think after the 2 week break, which should have been a time to recoup, relax, and get our mojo back after what's been a tough month. I think it was just what the doctor ordered for us, but it was a reaction from the team. It was a reaction from the squad to say, okay, we've had a lot of links with players away, but you know, we're still professional. We'll still go about our job and we'll still do our best for Newcastle United. Kieran Trippier gave quite an extensive interview after the game with Matthew Raisbeck on BBC Radio Newcastle, and I thought it was superb. I listened to it again last night just to refresh my memory, but he admitted that there'd been interest from Bayern Munich. He admitted that, you know, it was flattering at his age to be considered, you know, a target by such a big team. However, he was fully committed to Newcastle, and you know, he was committed to the team, committed to the, you know, the quest for, you know, continuing the run in the FA Cup and getting back up the league into the European slot. And I thought it was an interview. You wouldn't have expected anything different from Kieran Trippier after the match, but he wasn't the player that was put forward by Newcastle United to do the interviews, because that's the way that tends to be the way it works. The club will select a player to put forward. The media will request somebody, and the club will put them forward. But Kieran actually asked if he could be the person interviewed. Razor, you know, obviously put that out there and said that was the case. So I felt it was. I felt it was poignant as well that he was, you know, he was saying that he hadn't been agitating for a movie. He came out and said that. It's you know, when you see it reported in the press, you think, are they just saying that? But he did come out and say it himself. So all in all, I think, you know, Trippier won't be going anywhere. And yeah. I think that's, you know, for me, that's a blessing. Eddie Howe, I think, was his usual self after the game, honest and straight to the point. I think he more or less said what I've said, you know, Newcastle weren't at it in the first half, but the second half we were. When you look at the stats, yeah, Fulham had the slight edge in possession. But you know, at the end of the day, Newcastle scored the goals and Fulham didn't, I think. And looking at the stats going into the game, that was always going to be the issue. Fulham have been a bit shot shy. They're not scoring goals at the moment, and ultimately the fact that they played midweek in a tough game against Liverpool and made 6 changes probably didn't help them. 6 changes was a lot. And you can see, you know, Fulham are struggling without like a target man like Mitrovic. You know, they sold goals in the summer to Saudi and they haven't really replaced them. So yeah, overall, you know, delighted. With regards to the cup draw, you know, we were last out of the hat last time. We were, you know, first out of the hat this time. And yeah, I mean, look, you know, avoiding Man City and Liverpool was basically what I wanted to see. I would have preferred a home draw. You've got Blackburn or Wrexham who play tonight. Of course, you know, Blackburn, you know, is, as I mentioned in my headlines, is somebody we're familiar with. We've had them four times in the last 10 FA Cup fifth round draws.
Didn't realise that. That's a lot, that, isn't it?
It's a hell of a stat, yeah. And we've you know, the last time we played them in the FA Cup fifth round, I think it was 2019, we beat them 4-2, Longstaff scored. I think, you know, if we get Wrexham, that'll be on the TV. There's no doubt about it. It'll be the standout tie of the round because of the two owners, you know. So yeah, that it will be interesting. I think, you know, I think Blackburn of course brings its own reunion, as I mentioned again, with John Dahl Thomason, you know, former Newcastle United player managing Blackburn. But I would like to think that Newcastle have got too much for either of those teams, and you know, we could take a berth, you know, in the quarters, which would be nice. You know, especially after the disappointment of going out of the Champions League, going out of the League Cup, you know, to have an FA Cup run would be fantastic. So yeah, I mean, it's like I said on Friday, it's kept our season. You know, it has to keep our season alive, and it certainly has. And we go into our next game tomorrow. You know, Aston Villa in the league tomorrow is huge. It's a big game.
Quick turnaround, isn't it?
It is big massive. Game for Villa, big game for Newcastle, but we go into it. We go into it on, you know, on a high. Villa, I think, drew with Chelsea, wasn't it, at the weekend in the FA Cup. They've got a replay, which is good for us. Those two having a replay again, another extra game for those guys. But yeah, it is a quick turnaround. I'm sure Newcastle will cope. The Champions League experience will have put them in good stead for that. But yeah, I'm a happy mag this weekend. You know, and it's like, you know, it's just nice. It keeps our season alive, and that's the main thing.
Two things for me I noticed about the game, mate. First of all, man of the match for me, I thought Dan Burn was absolutely tremendous.
Incredible.
He really had a fantastic game, very impressive. And that sticks in my throat because I know he's a Geordie as well. Like, and obviously, I think that brings a little bit extra out of North East players in general, to be honest, when they're representing their own clubs and maybe not even come through the academies, but returning back to the club they've supported. You always just get that extra 10% out the tank, I think. And he played like that on Saturday. I was really, really impressed with his performance. Took his goal well. I mean, it was a centre-back's finish or a left-back's finish, but it was still quality. The other thing I noticed, though, Steve, and you touched on the Lee Dixon thing, and we'll bring the lads in on this one as well. Lee Dixon slipped up a bit, lads. Didn't he?
Why?
He let slip about VAR and the fact that commentators can hear the decision being made.
Wasn't it?
Yes.
It was one of those moments where when he said it and there was that awkward silence of, oh, no, you've given away a bit of the magic there, Lee. That's a bit of an interesting one. Sneaky commentator.
Yeah, well, I've always thought this, and I mean, I don't know whether the VAR, I doubt the VAR officials would have like a reciprocal, like, you know, hearing. I could imagine they've got the TV on. I've said this a few times. I wonder if they've got the Sky coverage on in the background of VAR, because you know, ultimately I think sometimes there's an overemphasis on Sky from the likes of Gary Neville. They're almost, I know their job is commentating on the game, but they almost re-emphasise. You know, that again, it's like this. Well, that's definitely a handball. You know, and I know they're doing the job, but you just think, you know, if these VAR officials have got a TV on in the background, their decision making could be impeded by the fact that they're listening to what the pundit says, because they don't want to make a mistake and think, oh, well, it's easier just going with the pundit because the pundits will
good
be happy.
Point.
Well, you know, it's a theory. It's not what happens, but it's a theory.
They'll have no audio on in the VAR room. They'll have all the replays and all the angles from Sky, absolutely, because it's the TV cameras that VAR is based on. But they won't have any audio on from the commentators.
Yeah, well, you say that, Dave, but you don't know that. I don't know that they have, but you don't know that they do.
Well, I do know how VAR works because I've been to many VAR rooms and looked at the infrastructure because, you know, I'm looking for opportunity to burn it at the stake. But, yeah, no, there's no facility for having commentators' audio on.
I mean, some of them were clearly watching the Ryder Cup when, you know, during that game that was played when they made that absolute balls up. I mean, you say which one, don't you, when I say that? But I can't remember which game it was. But the Ryder Cup was on. It was coming to a key moment. And a lot of people genuinely thought they were probably watching the golf. It's that bad. It is that bad. It really is. But, yeah, Lee Dixon. I didn't think we'd get worse than Lee.
There, Steve.
I
didn't understand why he was going in on them. I mean, obviously, great entertainment for me, being a Matt, but it just seemed like, is there some previous there that we're not aware of?
No, but you just see it all the time with commentators. When they're commentating on Newcastle's games, they're almost championing the opposition, no matter who it is. And it's because, you know, they've all got an opinion, I guess, on Newcastle coming into, you know, into contention but potentially winning something. I mean, yeah. God help us if Lee Dixon's commentating, you know, on a cup final that we win. My God, you know, it'll be nauseous. I mean, that hasn't been the most nauseating thing of the weekend for me, by the way. And we'll get to it, of course, because
before you go on to it, Barry's just WhatsApped on the Lee Dixon point. He said, totally agree with Steve. Morning, Barry, by the way. Totally agree with Steve about Dixon. Loved the Trippier interview. We got through, wasn't pretty, but we're in the next round. How many other clubs aren't? Great show, lads.
Yeah, thanks, Barry.
Fair point.
Yeah, I mean, the whole thing with Lee Dixon is just, you know, it just emphasises that there's an agenda from some of these people in the media against Newcastle. Not everybody.
Oh, mate, no, come on, surely. I mean, I didn't see it. I've got to be honest. I watched the Sunderland
game.
Well, there
you go.
Game,
you didn't see it, Dave. So you
I didn't
can't
see
comment.
The
Dave's taking a finger approach.
Yeah, definitely. I didn't see it because I just shut my eyes and refused to accept it. And ears. I had my fingers in my ears. No, I didn't see it. But are you not just a little bit oversensitive because obviously it's Newcastle, your beloved Newcastle?
Nope.
No, really not. Was it that bad?
I'm a 52-year-old man, Dave. I'm a 52-year-old man and I've listened to plenty of comedy over the years. And I do, thank you. And I do know what is right and what is wrong. And if there's a club that's getting slated by a particular individual, and the fact is, Dave, they admitted on air that we're being slightly over the top with Newcastle. So that condemns them even. It condemns them for me because they've held their hands up and said, actually, and it wasn't Lee Dixon who said it. It was, I can't remember who the other guy was now, but it was the co-commentator. And he more or less said, you know, they must have had complaints. Well, they were getting complaints online.
Do you think it's the Saudi? Is it the Saudi factor? Is that what it is? Do you think
it's a bit of that?
Yes.
Yeah. Some people it will be the Saudi factor, but other people it's just the fact that Newcastle had, how dare they gear crash, you know, the party, you know, how dare they affect the top six, the beloved top six, of course, which Lee Dixon was a part of, you know, with Arsenal.
But wasn't Leicester welcomed with open arms that year that won the Premier League?
Yeah, because they knew it was going to be a one-off.
Hasn't Brighton been welcomed to, you know, into the party by commentators?
Because they're not a big club. Leicester and Brighton aren't big clubs. Yeah. They're
plucky
not big
underdog.
Clubs. The plucky underdog who wins it once in a blue moon is going to happen, and we're going to accept that. But not Newcastle, who's got ambitions to be there for the rest of, you know, the rest of their history. You know, that's why it is. It's sour grapes. It's awful, and it's awful, and it's obvious. That's the worst thing about it. And you know, Lee Dixon, you know, was criticised and rightly so.
Good.
Well, we'll come up the sports headlines, lads. We'll do Sunderland after the headlines. But, Dave, play the music.
Together across the northeast. The Timbercat and the Red.
What? Seamless.
It's what the fact.
Ted is sick.
And quick. Nothing else rhymes.
And no,
rise up pain.
Ted is sick and no.
Don't encourage them.
Well, Borough fans.
It is what the fact. You know how it works by now. Danil, I know you're poised, you're coiled like a viper by the phone, ready to WhatsApp us on this one. I have an amazing football fact for you. I'm going to give you four clues. You've got to guess what the fact, which is very difficult to say when you're loaded with cold. But there you go. Anyway, we're going to crack on. We've got the first clue for you right now. An international fixture that's never gone the way you'd expect. That's an international fixture that's never gone the way you'd expect.
Ah, okay.
India playing England in Hyderabad.
Sorry, an international football fixture that's never gone the way you'd expect. But hats off to you on that one, mate. Yeah, nobody saw that coming.
What a win. Yeah, that was warm.
Yeah, fantastic win, wasn't it? Anyway, come on, this is what the fact, not what the wicket.
Sorry.
Yes, an international football fixture that's never gone the way you'd expect. That's your first of four. Any sort of feelings in your water yet, lads?
No.
Or is it just like
nah.
A...
Nah,
pass.
No.
I prefer the geography method. Ones.
I see.
I've adopted the Wraith approach.
Okay,
It's known in the industry as doing a Wraithy.
Ah, but Wraithy likes this quiz. See, you've got to appeal to
That's
him.
True.
You've got to appeal to his nice side.
That's true.
Yeah. You know, you've got
I feel like the quiz is very Newcastle biased.
Yeah.
Like
what?
Lee Dixon. It's just Newcastle biased. You know what I mean?
Is it really? Okay.
By the way, we've got to say good morning to Paul. Paul sent a WhatsApp into the studio over the weekend. We don't quite know which show he's referring to, but we'll claim it.
Okay.
It says, just cottoned onto this show. Brilliant banter. I'll be a regular listener from now on. So we'll claim that one, won't we? We'll claim
that's
that.
That's us.
Yeah, yeah.
That's us.
Yeah.
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 It's definitely us. Morning, Paul. Legends can't have that one.
Yeah. Nah.
Look, they've had their turn in the sunshine.
But good morning.
Nah.
Good morning.
Good morning, lads, yes.
Yeah. Legends, yeah. Hmm.
I did have a thought over the weekend. Now, I'm putting this out live on air, which you'll probably not thank me for later. But I think we should have a little quiz team up with the Legends.
Ooh.
I like it.
Me and Daz, Ryan Higgy and Clarky and Steve. And we need an independent quiz master. And I think Dave's got a face of a quiz master.
I actually teamed up with Clarky years ago on a TV pilot with me. The team was me and my dad, Clarky and John McCrurick.
Oh my word, what a team up.
And we won the quiz, but it never the TV show was never put out there, but I've still got the video footage somewhere. I'll send you it, lads. I'm not sure if I've got the quiz, but I've got the audition, but I will send that to you.
I did. Go on, mate, sorry.
No, you go on.
I was just going to say I did something similar a long time ago when I was the Borough commentator for Century, and I was also doing the Big Mal football phoning. So we had, this was pre-Legends, and Malcolm Allison. It was great, wasn't it? It's like, Dave, we've got no history of doing any football. We're going to sit here in a studio for 2 hours, Monday to Friday, from I think it was 6 till 8, with Malcolm Allison. You're going to talk football to an audience that isn't used to us talking football to. Brilliant, brilliant. No songs, no records, no nothing. But anyway, we decided to take it on the road, and we got Neil Cox, who was Borough fullback at the time, myself, Ali Brownlee, who are obviously on Century, and Malcolm Allison.
Legend.
And was Higgy with us that night? I can't remember if Higgy was with us that night. And we went to the Nunthorpe Social Club.
Yes.
Because we went around all the social clubs on Teesside doing this. It was a quiz. It was our team against the social club's team in a quiz. And Ali typically was the unbiased quiz master. And we drew. So at the end of the night, it was a draw.
Really?
So we left it up to the audience. We left it up, foolishly, left it up to the audience in the pub to decide what the fact the old panel, the decider was going to be. So they came up with a sudden death decider of doing a forfeit. And the forfeit we were given and won it was for Neil Cox to kiss Malcolm Allison.
Dang it, mate.
And he did it. Coxie just stuck the lips on Big Mal. Yeah, absolutely.
Win's a win, isn't it?
A win's a win, yeah. I think he said something like that. Oh, it was brilliant. It was brilliant. But those were the days when players were approachable.
Wow.
I'm also fascinated about what John McCrick was like in person. Because, I mean, we saw him on Celebrity Big Brother. He's just like this cantankerous, larger-than-life figure, Steve. Like, I know we're going off-piste, Steve. We had no plan. But what was he like, mate? Because I'm intrigued.
Every bit as eccentric as he was on TV. He just what you saw on TV is what you got in real life. He was a lovely, lovely guy. Obviously set in his ways. He would be certainly banned nowadays, I think, off from television.
Yeah.
There's no doubt about it. But no, just he just. John McCrute was a racing legend, you know, but a huge, huge Newcastle fan. And that's what TV misses, really, I think, these days. Yeah. It misses characters like that. Yeah. We've now gone down this completely woke, you know, route of, putting people
sterile
in front of
TV,
the camera.
Isn't it?
Sterile TV is a wonderful way of describing it. It's exactly that. And, you know, I sit and cringe now when I watch football matches, when I watch live TV, you know, 24-hour sports channels. They're awful.
Or watch-alongs.
Well, no, that's all right. That actually, considering I'm a Newcastle fan, at least that's the kind of stuff that should happen. It should be spontaneous. It should be a laugh. It's why it's why Dave set this show up. You know what I mean? It's be real, not fake. And it, you know, without naming names, some of the people who do this, I know them quite well, and I cringe. I really do. I think it's cringeworthy TV, and I think they've gone from as well the whole. The notion of getting supporters on TV, something which I was very much a part of when it's how I met Dave, you know, putting my fanzine out and being interviewed on TV. I think we've now gone I've got to be careful how I word this. I think genuinely the people who represent.
I thought he was going on a joy earlier when he started this.
the people who represent. Clubs in general now aren't necessarily fans of the football club. They maybe haven't been there for a sustained period. They're going for people who are, you know, over the top in supporting certain movements, and for me that's not acceptable. And it's simple for me. I just don't watch it. I switch it off. There's programmes I probably would have watched years ago, or maybe I would have contributed to years ago. I just don't watch them anymore because, I don't want a particular narrative rammed down my throat. And you know, I just want to listen about. I want to listen to what the team news is, what somebody's view is of whether that person should be playing in that position or not. And I want to listen to somebody whose opinion I can either respect or disagree with respectfully. But we've gone completely down a different angle now. And
the world's gone that way, Steve.
It has, yeah. I don't like it, mate. I don't like it at all. And some things you just think, I'm quite cynical about certain things as well. You know, I think, well, they've just done that because they want that particular angle to be covered, and it becomes a nightmare, you know, for media companies to, you know, to try and find out, I guess, a genuine fan from not a genuine fan, you know. But this is part and parcel as well of our takeover. Sadly, we're seeing it with the takeover. New supporters have arrived at the club. Not many, but you know there are a few, and it's just part and parcel.
In their horse-drawn carriages.
Before I forget, lads, because we're moving swiftly on. I know you've got lots of other topics. Well done. Fair play to Alan Shearer. As well, 1985 was the last time he was on the terraces following Newcastle, but he loved it, and I watched his little interview on Match of the Day yesterday. He was covering the Newport Manchester United game. Gary Lineker asked him about what it was like on the away end, and he said, "Were you a bit embarrassed when they started singing your song?" And he went, "No, I loved it." and then he got Mika Richards and Gary Lineker to sing the song.
But hang on, I've got a question on that one. I've got a question. Isn't St James's sold out and people wait on waiting lists for tickets? How did Shearer get a ticket?
Well, this is an away
game. Alan Shearer.
He's played over 200 games and scored over 200 goals for Newcastle United. That's his likely points, mate.
All right.
I'd say that.
Would you have given him if you'd have gone down there and Shearer was stood outside saying, "I want to go on the terraces, lads," would you have given him your ticket?
Why, aye, of course, definitely, not a problem. If he didn't have a ticket, I would have given him my ticket for what he did for Newcastle United. Of course, I don't think anyone's got any objections towards it, and I think the Sunderland game, Ryan Taylor, Shola Amiobi, and Nobby Solano had tickets, and the club have been honest about it. They've said we reserve some tickets for away ends for close friends and family of club officials and players.
Wonder if he got ID. Did he get ID'd before he walked in?
There was no ID in yesterday.
It's all falling apart. Well, I'm trying to wind it up, but it's all falling apart.
I bumped into somebody at the weekend at the deal that I did on Thursday with Keegan, Waddle and Beardsley, and this guy came up, he had a wonderful story. He says, I've only ever been starstruck once. He says, I was on an easy jet flight. He says, because he's cabin crew, this guy. And he says, sometimes you just look at the boarding passes as they're coming on, because they're coming on thick and fast. And he says, somebody handed us this ticket. I looked at it and it was Alan Shearer. He says, and I looked up and he says, I've never been starstruck in my life. And he went, hello, Alan, are you okay?
I sat on a plane last year. I was doing some FIFA work, and I got on there. This guy was, it was business class, I'll have to say it. And I got to the seat, there's this guy on his phone.
Of course it was.
Yeah, it was. I didn't buy the ticket. And
business class, it was your plane.
then I'd be flying it, mate. And this guy's already got on board, and he's on his phone. And he turned out to be the most arrogant git I've ever come across. He was arrogant with the cabin staff. I tried to, because I was sitting next to him, tried to start a conversation. He just looked down his nose to say, "What piece of crap are you to try and talk to me?" It was Edgar Davids.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. Was he wearing glasses?
Yeah. Yeah. He does.
Does this after he was manager of Barnet and insisted on the number one jersey?
Yeah, I was really disappointed with that one. He was a right prat. I thought, I'd give up now, mate.
Wow.
You know, we've got a 7.5 hour flight ahead of us, and I'm sitting next to you. You're watching football. I made a comment about the game, and he just sort of looked down his nose at me as to say, "Who are you?" So there you go. Anyway, look, we've got a message in, because I know you're going to switch on to this subject. Barry's been, and he said, "Hey, what's all this with Clippity Klopp?" The press didn't make this much fun when Fergie left, Dalgleish left. You know, Klopp's a twisty man, and I'll be glad to see him gone.
Hysterical.
We just need Arteta to shut up now. So, thanks for that one, Barry.
Yes, we will get round to that one, but we are going to talk a bit of Sunderland first, if that's all right with you, lads. You know,
mate, sure, sure, get on with it.
The only other big North East team played on Saturday as well.
Real Madrid.
Real Madrid back in form.
Big North East team. Bealey? Yes, Bealey said? Come on.
Yes, Bealey. For Beale. Look, lads, we needed that. We absolutely needed that. It was commented to me even after the show on Friday. Geordie Charlie messaged me and said, "That's the most downbeat I've ever heard you talk about Sunderland."
Yeah.
Because obviously I predicted a 2-0 defeat.
I honestly thought it was going that way.
Yeah, to be honest, it was Stoke are much improved, by the way. Schumacher's got them playing some decent football, but they couldn't stick the chances away. And it's a little bit like the Newcastle game in a sense that there was some good opportunities there for Stoke. But if you don't stick them away, don't find the back of the net, then you get punished for them. And as that game went on, you could see Sunderland finding a little bit of form and a little bit of a bit of confidence in the way they played. Certainly in the second half, anyway. Abdullah Bar probably had his best game in a red and white shirt. Obviously, it was very, very disappointing an hour before kickoff getting the news about Pritchard refusing to play and withdrawing.
Wow,
do you know what? I've had time to digest that. I didn't want to react too much at the time. Now that I've had time to digest that, that's bad crack. Just be involved in the squad for one more game, see it through, and then get your move. Because it's going to happen this week anyway. That's all he had to do. And he did this at Huddersfield as well, by the way. He forced a move by doing this before.
Yeah, he's got form.
Yeah, so do you know what? No one player is ever going to be bigger than our team. So I'm disappointed in Pritchard because he's somebody who I rate as a technical player.
Yeah, you did.
Fantastic little player. But, you know, over the last few weeks, he's been very, very grumbly. He's had, you know, quite a lot of moaning and a couple of digs at some of the young lads. All right, Aushish had a bit of a mare at Ipswich, but having digs at them publicly like that, you can't do it. You can't be cynical with young players. They're essentially kids, and you can't be like that with them. So I think maybe something's gone on behind closed doors. He's spat his dummy out completely, and that's
there's
it.
There's lots of rumours about it, though, isn't there? There's lots of rumours of potential breakdowns.
There's rumours of all sorts, mate. There's refusal to take part in a dance-off. There's refusal to take part in a sing-off.
There's all this sort of stuff. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
There's apparently he's been crying because Beale's been mean to some of the young kids.
Yeah,
now,
heard that one as well.
It's the rumour mill. It's silly. You know, it is what it is. Unfortunately for Pritchard, as Steve's rightly put it, he's got form. He did this before with Huddersfield, so that's what's going to tarnish what has been actually a decent stint with us. He's looked like a Premier League player. He wouldn't have looked out of place in the Premier League. He's got that technical ability, low centre of gravity. He's got a shot on him. So if that's it for Alex Pritchard, that's it for Alex Pritchard. But I tell you what,
Birmingham,
Abdullah Bar stepped into that. And stepped into that role. All right, he was coming in off the right-hand side, but I thought Barr was absolutely tremendous. Took his goal really well. He knocked out a beautiful ball to the left flank for Clark to run onto. Clark had the presence of mind to look for this neat little cutback, and Barr just finished like a striker, to be honest. It was a lovely pass into the net. Two players I really want to single out now. One of them did score an own goal. But I thought Patterson could have probably done a little bit more to keep that out. But there you go. Jensen Seelt, I thought, was absolutely magnificent. I think we're going to see a lot more of him. We've got Dan Ballard, who is one yellow card away from his 10th of the season. So he'll miss two games, I think it is, for that now, isn't it? And 09 is two yellow cards away from the same feat as well. So we are going to see Jensen Seelt playing in his natural centre-back position very soon.
Triantis.
Probably after the Borough game, I would imagine. Triantis, do you know what, right? He deserves his shout because the kid apparently works so hard in training. He's caught a lot of people's eye there and he's improving all the time. I'd like to see him given the chance as well. Of course, you've got a vested interest in that as well because, he's somebody who's probably been looked at for the next Aussie squad, the senior squad as well, you know?
Yeah, he is.
Sealed, I thought, was absolutely magnificent. For such a big lad playing out of position at right back, I thought he got down the channels well. He was very, very strong in the tackle. He was positionally very, very smart as well. But lads, I'll tell you who played absolutely magnificently was Luke O'Nine at centre back. He was absolutely
your mate,
Luke.
He was incredible. He had a fantastic game. It was his 250th game for the club, and I was just so impressed. So impressed with the way he went about stuff. There was clearances off the line. There was his control was good. His passing out of defence was good. And when you get games like that, as long as it's not against giant centre forwards and all that sort of thing, because that's when he gets pulled about and out of position and gets involved in the silly stuff. When you're playing against somebody like Stoke, who are in this sort of transitional period where they're trying to be a bit more technical in their play rather than miss out the midfield altogether and bomb it up to the big man, Luke actually has the technical ability to be able to bring it out of defence. When he's got time on the ball, he looks a different player. It's just you're not going to get that every single game. So tailored to the right occasion, Luke, I just thought he was absolutely brilliant. That's my monthly compliment to Luke O'Nine done. Mason Burstow got off the mark as well, which was a huge, huge relief to that lad. And you could see in his play after, Mason Burstow worked very, very hard before his goal. He was trying his best to go up against centre backs that are much, much bigger than him, much stronger than him, and kind of almost playing as a lone striker as well. Yeah.
I credit it to my honestly, little WhatsApp message.
Well, is that what it was it?
Yeah, that was me, yep.
He really, really ran his socks off. And then the opportunity come. It wasn't a nice goal by any means. It was, it was 2 yards out. It was a stoop and header. But it goes in, and now he's off the mark. And the difference in his face, you could see the way he celebrated to the fans. The double fist pump and going on. It meant a lot to him. That's his first senior goal in front of the home fans as well. It looked like instant relief for him. So hopefully, that's two of our strikers off the mark now. Maybe just a little bit of confidence starting to creep in before the Derbish on Sunday, which I believe we're doing a live watch-along, aren't we?
Are we?
We are, yeah.
News to me.
Yeah. Yeah, well, yeah, Ted and I and Stevie
you've
in the middle.
Sunday
yeah.
off, mate.
Yep.
So, well yep. I booked the pub.
Yeah.
So yeah. Listen, I mean, who knows what's going to happen up until the rest of the transfer window, but there's performances there that I thought were very, very encouraging out of our team. Obviously, we've still got these issues in defence where we're still having to play players out of position. That's probably not going to change anytime soon unless there's a real surprise. But midfield and the top end of the pitch, it was nice for Jack Clark to kind of not be the star of the show for this game. He still played very, very well. Don't
still
get
was.
Me wrong, by the way. He was excellent. He was excellent.
Crazy.
But
yeah.
when somebody like Barr steps it up and takes that pressure off and gives the defenders just something else to think, because, you know, it's nearly always, right, get it out to Clarky, get it out to Clarky. Well, you know, having that other option of Barr who can either get down the right or cut inside and play neat little balls. I don't think I saw Barr actually place a misplaced pass the whole game. Everything seemed to find the intended target. So that takes the pressure off. Clarky, by the looks of things, is not going to be sold this window as well, but we'll come up with the transfer window stuff in the next half. But yeah, it was just a really, really solid performance. Did you watch the game, Rye?
I did. Yep. I watched the first half, then fell asleep because it was like 2 a.m. my time. But I watched the first half, and then when I woke up, I watched the highlights for the second half, and I was impressed because I went in like you guys thinking it was going to be a Stoke win. I even put a bet on Stoke winning, and I was I was all for it. So it was incredible to see the Sunderland performance that it was. I mean, I do agree. I think Stoke have changed. Stoke used to be an absolute bore to watch. My goodness me, under Alex Neil, that was some really bad football. When you used to hate playing them with Alex Neil type of football. But that was you. I completely agree. I think Schumacher's got them playing very exciting. I put a bet on Lyndon Gooch to score as well. But it was good to see his reception as well. Yeah. But I thought you guys just you took your chances, and that's good teams do that. I mean, it was like Rotherham for us, where we had 38 chances, missed it, and then Rotherham scored. You know what I mean? It's one of those. But they didn't take the chances, and you guys did. And it was it was funny to see Mason Burstow. We were talking in pre-match that Sunderland need to choose one striker and get on with it. But Roosan on the bench, Burstow in, and he takes it and scores, which is you could see the relief on his face. Such a young kid. He's probably been through the ringer this season with, am I good enough? What's happening? I should be performing at this level. I'm a Chelsea youngster, yada, yada, yada. And finally he gets off the mark. So I think, it was just utter relief for them. But yeah, it was a good game. It was exciting to see a better Stoke City, not a boring Stoke City. So I think you're absolutely right. I think a few more signings are through, a few more Schumachers. And they'll be right, ready to watch. And Sunderland took their chance as well, which and then Bealey coming out afterwards and saying he's looking forward to the local derby, which is it's a strange narrative for him to keep pushing, but whatever.
I think he's referring to getting promoted and obviously playing the derby next season, mate. I think you've maybe misunderstood that.
So is it a contract extension then? Now the fans are shouting for with Michael Bealey.
Yep. I heard. That's what I heard.
Look, it's going to take a lot to win the fans over. That was a step in the right direction. I was waiting with bated breath for his interview at the end of the game.
You looked I was petrified for the first 30 minutes of that game. I thought Stoke were going to do you. It was only when you got the second goal see the confidence, the self-belief come back into Sunderland. But it took that second goal for that to happen.
It was always going to be nervy, I think, because of the week that had. Obviously, the club statement about Pritchard went out an hour before kickoff, which I don't think that was good timing. I don't know what the thought process was there.
Was it to hide it because of the build-up to the game so close to kickoff?
I mean, it was just before the team news, and everyone would have been like, "Where's Pritchard? Where's Pritchard? Where's?" So
I think that's why they had to put it out.
That's why they had to say it. But it was the timing of it was wild. I mean, if their week hadn't have been worse enough to have that, 10 minutes between when they got Beal out and all that sort of stuff, and if they can you imagine Sunderland had a lost 3-1, and they had the Pritchard announcement, we'd be sitting here right now with a very, very sick Ted and a very, very wildly angry Ted. But thankfully they still managed to get over the line, even though, you know, all that, that's gone down. So, which it's a credit to them, because as I said, I thought it was going to be an easy Stoke win, especially with the Pritchard announcement, which seems to have, you know.
Yeah, it's added a bit of spice to the weekend coming, hasn't it? Because it has, Sunderland have lost and even more turned on Beale. I'd have written you off, Ted, at that point for the weekend coming. I really would,
the only thing that would have saved that, Dave, I get what you're saying, but the only thing that would have saved that is the fact that we're away fans, and the away fans are a different voice.
Yeah.
They are your fanatics.
That's true. That is true.
And no matter what the situation, they would have been in fine voice at the Riverside, and they're going to be. They absolutely are going to be. It's a you know, cracking little afternoon out. It's not too far away. It's not a derby, but it's still. Still new. He's still new. Give him time.
So
like I've always said with Michael Beale, give him time.
Yeah, Mogger said it.
Yeah.
Mogger's a smoggy.
Mogger's
a smoggy. He's desperate for it to
if
be a derby as well.
Is Ted. He is a bit sick, but he's all up for Beale. Hashtag Beale in. I think we got Jimmy Coppers on very soon. But and if you're listening, Jimmy, Beale in. Breaking news here from Ted Boy.
No, listen, he's bought himself some time. And I'm being honest about it now. He's bought himself a little bit more time. That was a much more encouraging display. All right, we didn't have the lion's share of the chances, but if we're going to be more potent with less chances in front of goal, fair enough. You know, if that's the way he's trying to coach it, winning games is all we care about. It's nice if we play fantastic football. I don't think we're going to see exactly the same as what we saw under Tony Mowbray. I think it is going to be a little bit more patient and considered. But winning games is all you can do. And that, you know, that stops you getting the sack as a football manager. So it's a good habit to get. Solid win. We take it. And you know, we look forward to Sunday. Not Saturday.
Saturday. Sunday. But
I'm not well.
Don't shout, it'll hurt your head.
I know. Should we cut to the news? So I'm going to take
a minute. Well, we could, but I want to know if Steve's still with us, because he hasn't spoken for 15 minutes.
Well, I did enough speaking for the first 45 minutes.
Okay, that's
Lee Dixon
fine.
And Jurgen Klopp and Newcastle United and Alan Shearer and everybody else. So, I'm just giving the co-presenters a chance to talk.
Yeah, no, that's fine, mate. I was just looking at our system because I hadn't heard you. I'm thinking, has he been cut off? Has his internet dropped? What's happened here? A couple of messages, a couple of WhatsApps before we go into the news. First one being Daniil. Good morning, Daniil.
Morning,
gents.
Good morning, Daniil.
Rather seems to be scarce in entertainment. Banter rather seems to be scarce in the entertainment world and in the everyday world. Thank God for the North East Footy Breakfast. Great job all.
Well,
thank you very much, mate.
P.S. Ted, the answer to what the fact England versus USA?
It's not.
Oh, I thought he was taking us down that 1950 classic route. And then one coming from...
We actually do have Jimmy Coppers coming on.
We do have Jimmy Coppers coming on. Yeah, he's going to be on about 15 minutes. And we have a comment in from a new contributor, ADB. Don't know what that means, but great show. Good morning, all.
Good morning, Andrew.
Hang on, he's not new. We've had him before. I think he's changed his name. Catching this morning's show, Mystic Meg Race. Lol, septic peg. That was his comment way back when we were new and we were fragile. Anyway, it is time for the news. We'll be right back after this.
From Yarm to Yibby, Harrington to Horsley Hill, Swalwell to Silverlink, the North East Footy Breakfast with Roy, Steve, and Ted.
Right across the North East. The Red, the Toon, and the Cat.
A bit of a cuddly toy there, Roachford, right across the northeast on the Cat, the Red, and the Toon. Tis the northeast footy breakfast show. What?
That's a
belter
of a track.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, it wasn't.
That isn't great. Got me in the mood.
We've had a message in from Jack. Good morning, Jack. I love
morning,
you,
Jack. Morning, Jack.
Morning, lads. Hope you're enjoying the show. What a difference a game makes. Beal is now the real deal. By the way, what the fact? Is it Norway?
Ooh.
What?
There were two points in one line, mate. You know, what a difference a game makes. Beal is now the real deal. He is a Borough fan, of course, so he's obviously got tongue in cheek. And what the fact? Is it Norway?
I'm going to need a little bit more than that.
That's just the name of the country.
He might have cracked it. That's why.
Norway isn't a fact. It's a destination, boys.
but he's warm, is he? Is he warm, Teddy?
I'm not saying.
Look at him.
You might be.
Come on. Let's have clue number two.
Yeah. Is it got anything to do with the World Cup final?
No.
Okay. I will end that line I was going to, you know, travel down. Okay, then we'll do this.
What the fact?
Ted's got a blood orange.
Right.
What the fact?
An international fixture that's never gone the way you'd expect was clue number one, gentlemen and ladies.
Uh-huh.
And everyone who listens. Clue number two. There's been some close shaves, but the record is intact. Yeah.
Who owns the Faroe?
That's got you thinking on it.
Who looks after the Faroe Islands? Which country is it? Denmark. Anybody know? Any geography?
I've got no idea. I'm just trying to see how you got the Faroe Islands.
Aren't they linked in? Well, I'm just thinking international fixture. Never always gone the way that you'd expect. Close shave. I'm just wondering if they've ever played each other. I mean, Faroe Islands is, I think it's its own nation in its own right, but isn't it? I don't know, isn't it? Linked? I don't know what the technical phrase is when a country is. I'm gonna stop talking because it's just not making any sense whatsoever.
I thought I was in a paracetamol haze there.
No, it's me not being able to choose my words because I'm too tired this morning.
What are you thinking of, Dave?
I was wondering whether there was some sort of Denmark Faroe Islands international that's been played a few times.
We just went Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas there, like.
Yeah, indeed. But as Sheryl Crow would say, I'm leaving Las Vegas. I'm back, boys.
Oh, well. So I'll give it one more time. There's been some close shaves, but the record is intact.
Gillette.
That's yes, you are on the right lines razor. With how that clue was intended.
Ooh. Gillette razor. Come on, lads, shave.
Four. I got nothing.
Referees putting lines on the pitch. No, internationals.
There's been some close shaves, but the record is intact.
Okay. Not there yet. But I think shaves is the key word in that line.
I think the third clue may point us more in the right direction.
I agree.
I'm going to select which one I'm going to give you. I've got a favourite clue.
He's even changing it as we go along.
He's just the order.
Making it up as we go along.
This was lovingly prepared last night from my sick bed, I'll have you know. You don't deserve me. Anyway.
Hang on. We had a WhatsApp in. Stephen the trucker has just sent us a WhatsApp in. Welcome to the show, mate. Welcome to the show. I think what the fact is that Norway has never lost to Brazil.
Stephen, you're never welcome again.
Oh, you got it.
You've got it.
Stevie boy.
On his debut.
Absolutely.
What a win.
I'm going to have to make this more difficult.
What the fact is out in 2024.
He deserves a bit of this.
Oh, absolutely.
Stevie Wonder.
Steve making his debut on the Breakfast Show.
Oh, he winged it straight
the
in.
The youngsters just banged one in from 20 yards out.
Oh,
so yes,
you
it's
what
an international fixture that's never gone the way you'd expect. The second clue,
well
there's
done,
been some
Steve.
Close shaves, Brazilian. Close shaves was a reference to Brazilian.
Wow.
But the record is intact. All those stars, but not one win. So the stars was in reference to the stars that Brazil have on their shirt for winning the World Cup.
Yes,
and
yes,
half the time, you just have to go with the flow. Because in half of the games, they've only played each other four times, Norway and Brazil. But Torre André Flo scored in two of the games against Brazil that they've been unbeaten in. So yes, jeez, Norway well is the only team in the
Get
world
in.
Who has played Brazil and never lost, winning two matches and drawing two on other occasions.
Well, Ted, you can vent well your done. Spleen to Stephen on Wednesday because he's with us on the show. He's actually joining us to talk about the British 24-hour karting race that the lads are trying to find some sponsorship for. They're entering from the North East, so a bunch of North East lads trying to enter that British event. So you can vent your spleen over spoiling your cunning little plan this morning on Wednesday.
I don't know where you were going with that there. Anyway.
I tell you what, you guys talk... Go on. You need it.
I was going to say, should we have some club headlines and we're going to have James on?
There you go. Who's up first? Who should we have first? Sunderland were last, weren't they, in the last hour? So
yes.
Get ready for it.
Mackems and Proud. Black Cats News.
Good morning, Sunderland fans. The world looks a lot better place after a win, doesn't it? Arsenal's Charles Sago Jr. is in talks with Sunderland over a proposed loan move ahead of the closure of the January transfer window this week, according to online and mainstream sources. The Gunners' promising winger has caught the attention of several clubs, but it's understood that it's the Black Cats who are pressing ahead for this signature. The 19-year-old has drawn comparisons to fellow Arsenal star Bukayo Saka, who is also a right winger and a product of the Hale End Academy. One winger that looks set to stay, however, is Jack Clark. Despite Sunderland rejecting an initial offer between £14 and £16 million from Lazio, with the club insisting the 23-year-old winger is not for sale. It's thought that Sunderland will wait and see the season out and listen to higher offers in the summer, although indications are that if Sunderland were to gain promotion this term, Clark may extend his tenure. And finally, Michael Beale responded to questions regarding Alex Pritchard after Sunderland confirmed he had demanded to leave the club this month, just an hour before kick-off on Saturday. Pritchard previously looked set to be forced out the door by Sunderland last summer, but ended up remaining at the stadium alike to fight for his place. Speaking to the Chronicle Live right after Saturday's 3-1 win over Stoke City, the Sunderland boss said, "It's been ongoing, to be honest, not just the last 24 hours. He's a boy who is coming up to the end of his contract, and he's been offered a one. I think mentally it's got a bit much for him. Let's keep the focus on the players who played today." And there are your Sunderland headlines.
Smoggies and Proud. Borough News.
Good morning, Borough fans. How are we, you beautiful humans? Hope you had a good weekend off. Not to get all farmy, but a weekend with no football is like having a cow that produces no milk, a pig that is too skinny for bacon, and a chicken that lays no eggs. Yeah. You're sad. In the biggest news to come out of football this weekend, new Sunderland manager has confirmed that this weekend's tie against Borough is a local derby. In another push to make it a derby, Beale was saying his team would be ready to go. Strange to see how much Sunderland want it to be a derby, am I right, Borough fans? The transfer deadline day for January is fast approaching, and the big story this week will be whether Borough remain on to Morgan Rogers or not. The former Manchester City youngster signed for Borough in the summer for a deal worth £1 million. However, it has now been revealed they are also including hefty sell-on margins from Man City. It has now been rumoured that Villa have submitted a third and final bid of £15 million, including add-ons. If true, and Borough do sell, they've managed to gain £14 million in the space of 6 months for one player. Crazy. And finally, Lucas Engel has said playing under insanely talented coach Michael Carrick has been incredible. The new left back has found form of late and slotted into the heart of the way Michael likes to play out from the back. Engel said he's experienced a lot and has an impressive CV. He's also a player I watched on television when I was growing up. So for him to be my coach is incredible. He's a role model for me and for many when he has played at the level he has. He's an insanely talented coach. My friends and family are all starstruck on my behalf, and I have some friends who are Manchester United fans, and they are starstruck as well. Well, get in, Lucas. On to the derby this weekend. Will or will not Morgan Rogers go? That is your Borough headlines. Good morning.
Magpies and proud. Mags News.
Goals from Sean Longstaff and Dan Byrne proved enough to send Newcastle United into the fifth round of the FA Cup on Saturday night. And Sunday's draw handed Eddie Howe's team a third successive away tie against either Blackburn Rovers or Wrexham, who played tonight. And were Rovers, managed by former Magpie John Doyle Thomason, to beat Wrexham, that would mean that no less than four of our last 10 fifth round ties would have been in opposition to Blackburn. Speculation on outgoing transfers continues to circulate in the media, and when asked about Miggy Almiron's absence post-match, Eddie Howe failed to calm Newcastle fans' nerves. Eddie, speaking to the media, said that he was ill, genuinely ill. Future, I want him to stay. Miggy to leave next week, it's difficult. I'm not in hourly contact with what's going on. There's a possibility that someone could leave. Newcastle's under-21 side suffered another defeat on Sunday, beaten by Blackburn Rovers in a Premier League 2 fixture staged at the Lancaster FA HQ in Leyland. A goal from Charlie Weston in the 20th minute of the first half separated the sides at half-time, only for United's Josh Scott to equalise with 20 minutes remaining. Rovers then won it when substitute Junior Nangu headed a corner past United keeper Rhys Byrne in the 86th minute. And Friday saw the latest Premier League fixture alterations for live TV announced, and only Wolves against Newcastle was a game under threat. The home meeting, though, will be a good old-fashioned 3 o'clock kickoff on Saturday, March the 2nd, with no TV coverage. That's your Newcastle headlines on Monday the 29th of January.
Together across the North East. The Turnback
Hat and the Red. And I'm pleased to say he's been hanging on listening to Borough News and Newcastle News. That's as useful as a chocolate fire guard for him.
He's
the Sunderland Echo's James Copley. Or Jimmy Cobbers, as he's now been nicknamed on this very show.
I named him. That was me. I'm proud of it.
Hey, something positive to talk about, James.
Thanks for that, James. Right. Appreciate it.
Yeah, something positive to talk about, mate.
I think you'll find it was me because you called me Rafe.
Yeah,
no, that's true. Yeah.
Everyone's claiming. We all know Rafe. Claiming it.
So it was me who called him Coppers. Oh. Anyway, I've just finished my box of chocolates from the Black Cats Lounge, so I'll let you crack on. You
know? That's fighting.
Don't take the bait.
Have we carried any coffins around Newcastle City
Centre? I did get the idea, Jimmy, from 1973, of course, when the Mackhams did it at Roker Park.
Yeah, something to celebrate that, though. Last time one of us won a cup.
Oh no, Borough did win a cup in the 90s.
I'm not
counting Borough, though.
Well, your manager is. He thinks it's a local derby.
Yeah, indeed.
Yeah,
the man who leads your team calls it a derby, mate. That's good enough for me.
Unfortunately, Michael Beale's mistaken.
Michael Beale's got more to worry about. It's not like him to make a mistake, though, James, is it? You know,
what can I do to read
the room.
It's great when we get guests on. We just bait them. It's terrible.
It is.
It is.
You're welcome, James. You're welcome to be on the show this morning, mate. I'm telling you.
Yes, I feel very, very loved, very appreciated.
3-1
well,
win.
I called you royalty on Twitter, mate. So,
you know.
That's at least great. I did. Yeah, yes. Well, you know, there's good and bad royalty, mate.
Yeah. We'll not get into that, bloody hell.
Listen, no, absolutely not. Obviously, last week, it just seems like we're a really bad daytime drama, the club at the moment. Like, and we seem to stumble from one thing to the next, but it went from everybody giving it the bailout to actually a solid win against Stoke City, let's call it. All right, Stoke may have had the better of the chances, but things looking slightly better going into this week than what they were last week. Is that a fair assessment?
Absolutely. Michael Beale really needed that result. I thought Sunderland played well in patches, reminded us of the Hull City away game, actually, in that Stoke could have had a few goals themselves. I think Sunderland rode the luck at times. Sunderland killed the game by scoring either side of half-time, but credit to them, credit to Beale. I thought the atmosphere in the Stadium of Light was very subdued. There had been some claims on social media that it was going to be wildly toxic. It wasn't at all. It was just very, very flat. Sunderland fans still celebrated the goals as they usually do. They were still behind the team, but there was no chance for Beale out, but there was no chance for Beale in either, even after the win. So I thought that was telling. I think he's got a long way to go. He's going to have to win a lot of games. And my fear is that he could beat Borough and he could beat Plymouth and he could beat the next team after that. And as soon as he hits a sticky patch again, this is all going to come up. Because I think Sunderland fans will remember this week what he said after Hull, what he said before Stoke City. It's going to be, it's not going anywhere, I don't think.
I mean, from your professional perspective, you covered it very unbiasedly, as you always do. It's always a good read. But as a Sunderland fan, what was your initial reaction to the outside noise?
to be careful.
I
wasn't impressed. I thought that was a bad move on his behalf. Sunderland fans aren't outside noise. I do think that by that terminology, he meant noise outside of his first team group and outside of the academy in the stadium. I do genuinely think that's what he meant. Obviously, it's been interpreted as wrong. But then in the next breath, when you talk about a lack of sort of respect and him being bemused and perplexed at the reaction towards him, I don't think that was the best choice of words either. At any football club, good luck if you decide to take on the fans. What I will say in Michael Beale's defence, though, is that after Stoke, he was quite humble and he did offer up the explanation of, we all get angry at times and stuff. And perhaps he does feel a bit slighted because of the mood around the club, decisions being made above him. He's right in what he says about it wasn't his decision to sack Tony Mowbray. It wasn't, but, he also didn't have to take the Sunderland job either. So he does have to, have to have some responsibility. And performances had dipped under him before the Stoke game. And I would actually say that some of the issues that Sunderland fans have pointed out, they are actually still there against Stoke City. I think Stoke City were very poor. And
papered over the cracks a little bit, maybe.
A little bit, maybe. I mean, all credit to them for winning. I do genuinely hope it's a springboard to better things. I do. I don't think anybody really wants them to fail, or certainly from my perspective, I don't want them to fail because I want the football club to do as best it can. I prefer reporting on happy than the sad. But it's interesting that afterwards, Stephen Schumacher, the Stoke City boss, was sort of lamenting his side not being able to find the back of the net and they're missing a striker as well with injuries and stuff. And it's ironic that there's another club and there's a fair few up and down the championship who would need a striker in January like Sunderland, but they're just hard to get. But the positive is Mason Burstow scored. Hopefully that can be a platform for him. My gut feeling is it's sort of a stay of execution rather than anything more. I hope he builds on it. But Michael Carrick and Middlesbrough are going to provide huge, huge test for him, especially away from home as well.
He doesn't say much, but when he does, he can. No.
He doesn't say much, are you kidding? Am I on the right show
now? Because you've invited me in. What shocked me, looking out, morning Jimmy Coppers as well. It was the Alex Pritchard announcement. Obviously, just going out before the team news. My thought was obviously they needed to get it out because the team news would have dropped and there'd be no Alex Pritchard and they'd be like, well, where is he? Did you think it was strange timing? Did you think it was normal timing? And did you see it coming from the outside?
I would have preferred it if they'd done it a couple of hours earlier or the night before, because we were all getting ready to talk about team news and preparing to cover a football match, and then that lands.
Dead cat strategy, wasn't it? Dead cat strategy. Game, team news coming out. Indeed. Let's throw it out now.
Yeah, let's throw it out when everybody's in the pub. But yeah, I think the message still got out. But I think you have to look at both sides of the aisle with this, as you always do. I think from my point of view as a Sunderland fan, somebody who covers the club, I was really disappointed in Alex Pritchard. He's under contract at the club and to not play, I think it's poor. But you do also have to understand where his head is at. He was told he could leave in the summer, move didn't materialise, he's ended up staying, he's played his way back into the team. He didn't think he was going to get offered a new contract. He's been offered a new contract, but it's almost a sort of symbolic offer. It's my understanding he's been offered like another year on the same money. He doesn't think that's acceptable. He wants longer term security, which is absolutely fair enough for a player of his age. Are Sunderland going to give him that long term security? No. So his camp feels slighted. I don't think they were too happy with the timing of Christian Speakman's comments in the week revealing that Pritchard had been offered a new deal. And I think one of the throwaway lines was, I'm sure he's happy. And then, you know, a couple of days later, he's not happy. And they would have known that he wasn't happy. Mm. So I think the timing of it, I think, you know, Sunderland have potentially tried to be a little clever and influence public opinion. And I think, you know, that's led to a bit of distrust. But, you know, for all the good Sunderland have done, they do get things wrong occasionally. And I think you have to be very careful with the way that you treat people. You know, this has shades really of Alex Neil and Tony Mowbray. Obviously, Alex Neil wasn't happy with his position. Should he have left when he did before a game? No, absolutely not. But, you know, that sort of mistrust between the people making the decisions and their employees, it was there with Alex Neil. It was certainly there with Tony Mowbray last summer as well. And it's come up with Alex Pritchard. So you do have to be careful in how you deal with people. I think there'll be shades of grey, and there'll obviously be, you know, things going on both sides, and I don't think any party's particularly, you know, fully in the wrong or fully in the right. I think there's a lot going on, and it's a shame because people tend to fall into one of two camps, don't they? They're either, you know, hammer the player or we'll hammer the board, and I genuinely think in this case it's somewhere in the middle. Unfortunately in football these things seem to happen quite regularly, and Sunderland won't be the last club, and they certainly weren't the first.
No, absolutely, mate. In terms of the building that trust, nothing's going to build trust like a couple of signings. And obviously, we're into the last week of deadline day. It's looming, what, Thursday, I think it is? Yeah.
Wednesday.
Rumours this Wednesday, sorry, yes. The rumours are this morning that we've made a move, apparently. Hjelde, from Leeds United.
Well, I'm glad you said the name, because... Yeah, I'm glad you've said the name, because I didn't know how to pronounce it. So we'll go with Hjelde.
I work with the Nordics, and I'm not. That's not an insult on the three lads I'm working with today.
Yes, it is. Yeah. It's always meant to be.
Well, I don't know. I've seen the reports myself. I've written a piece for the Sunderland Echo. It's not a transfer I know too much about myself. It does make sense because he can play centre back and left back. It's been reported by the Telegraph. It was reported by Alan Nixon of the Sun yesterday, and Mike McGrath this morning. So that would suggest that something's going on. If that's the noise, he's not in the Leeds team, so that adds up. I think he's only had one Carabao Cup appearance this season. Obviously, Sunderland need cover at left back because Huggins is out, as is Dennis Sergen. And if he can play both left back and centre back, that's good. I think he's only 19 or 20 as well.
Yeah.
Norwegian youth international. Leeds fans seem to rate him highly. He was in Daniel Farke's team in pre-season, but it's just not worked. I mean, they've got Sam Byram, who's been a real good player for them. So is he going to get in? Probably not. What surprised me, actually, is that it was reported yesterday that it was a potential loan deal. It now seems to have progressed to a permanent, which I think is ideal because, you know, we need players in the door that are ours, don't we? I think that certainly feels to me, although I don't know too much about it myself, it certainly seems to me like that one's got legs and could go through. But you mentioned, you know, we're in the final days now, so I think we need to see an acceleration.
We do
in the business, because it could be a busy deadline day.
Do you reckon we're going to see Ahmad?
Well, he caused a bit of a.
It's an interesting one, isn't it?
Social media last night,
after the match.
I actually couldn't believe it, because when I checked the team sheet, Manchester United versus Newport, or Newport versus Manchester United, I should say, he was on the bench, and I was expecting him to start. Erik ten Hag named a really strong side. There was Anthony, Martinez, Varane, you know, there were top quality players in there. Casemiro played, but I actually thought Ahmad would sneak in. And then you're sort of following it, watching it like everybody else, thinking, well, he'd bring Ahmad on at some point, especially when they went 3-2, 4-2. That didn't come, so that led to speculation on social media. Sunderland fans were saying, you know, Ahmad, you need to come back to Sunderland if they can't even bring you on against Newport County. He then liked a tweet to that effect. That tweet was swiftly unliked, and then there was messages coming out saying that it was a mistake, and people were being briefed left, right, and centre. And then this morning, the news is from some of the Manchester United pages that he would actually be open to a move, and he's going to try and force one. I don't know how true that is. But it genuinely is a strange one with the Mad and Manchester United. I think we look at it from a Sunderland point of view quite a lot, but he got into the team off the bench against Nottingham Forest a couple of weeks ago, might even be a month ago now. He came on, Manchester United lost that game. Erik ten Hag, the noises had been that Ahmad was going to be set for a chance. He then missed the next two games, one of which was against Wigan in the FA Cup. That was supposed to be down to an illness, it was said. He's not featured since. He was on the bench a couple of times, and then he was on the bench against Newport. And if ever there was going to be a game to give him mad minutes, it should have been against Newport, surely.
Yeah.
I mean, Newport played League Two, and you know, Ahmad ripped the Championship up last season, so you would have thought that, you know, if Erik ten Hag really does see the value in him and trusts him, then that would have been the game. He's not ill. He's fit enough for the bench, so... I don't know. It's one of those, isn't it, where there's a will, there's a way. And could he push a move through? Will he do that? Does he want to? I don't know. I think he wants to play games. Is he going to get that at Manchester United? Probably not. I think Erik ten Hag, you know, is struggling in many ways as Manchester United manager and has a lot of problems. And, you know, if he stays, Ahmad could become a casualty of that, where he's sort of brushed to the side. And that's not something he wants or needs at his stage of his development.
No, he needs football.
Yeah, from a Sunderland point of view, they can give him that football. He loves the club. But, you know, even if Manchester United did decide to loan him out last minute, it still could present a really tricky deal for Sunderland to get done, simply because there might be interest from a bottom-half Premier League team. There might be interest from a top league in Europe. So, Sunderland mightn't be able to compete with that, and it comes down to wage contributions and stuff like that. So... It's very interesting. It doesn't look like he would go to another club in the Championship, despite interest from Borough and Leicester City. I think it would be Sunderland if it was a Championship. But yeah, a lot at play. But my gut instinct is that he'll stay put.
And do we need to offer your congratulations? I picked up on social media. Was this your first Sunderland match report?
It was. Yes.
Yay!
So I've been working under Phil Smith at the Echo for the past 5 years. He's the main.
Congrats.
Yeah, so I was quite pleased because I used to deliver the Sunderland Echo around the streets of Hendon, believe it or not, when I was a kid.
The bike's still got two wheels on.
Yeah, I know. I'm well aware of the history. Well aware of the history of the Echo and the Argus, you know, who was the sort of unnamed Sunderland correspondent during the interwar years and stuff like that. And then I came to Story and Graham Anderson and... Chris Young and then to Phil. So yeah, it was a nice feeling because I'm a Sunderland man through and through. So yeah, it was good. Hopefully the first of many, but I don't really want Phil to go anywhere fast. So we'll have to see what happens.
Well, congratulations, mate. Well done.
Thank you very much. Cheers.
Are we done with Jimmy Coppers then, lads? Or is somebody going to throw some more barbs in his general direction?
We've got them all out of the way at the start, didn't we?
We were just wondering, because that's how it started. No, brilliant. James, wish you well. How about you popping on Friday? Are you free Friday? I mean, there's a game at the weekend.
Yes, I am off on Friday, so just give me a shout.
Good man. That's what we like to
see. Fantastic.
Thanks, James. Cool. Appreciate
it. See
you later. All the best.
Bye, James.
Bye. James Copley, the Sunderland Football Club writer at the Sunderland Echo, joining us on the North East Footy Breakfast. Just giving Ted a little bit of support in his hour of illness.
Yes, indeed. Thank you very much. It is much appreciated. God, I'm going to cough 2 seconds.
Oh, well, we've got to do a quick break. So cough your lungs up, mate. We'll be right back.
Together across the North East. The Tim Blackhead
and the Red. Well, Ted's at a loss because obviously we watered the fact at him. I'm very careful how I say that.
Wow.
Very careful how I say that.
I've thought of a better way to put it.
I know of an easy way to put it, but it'll get me shut down. Jack's been back on. He just wanted to point out, why do you think I said Norway? So,
on, Jackie.
Just saying Norway isn't the clue, isn't like the full fact, is it?
Oh, dear doctor. And anyway, we've had one in, we've had one winging in from Thailand. Good afternoon from Thailand to the best football talk show on the radio. We do like the cut of that line. I hope you guys are well. Up the borough. Let's bring on Sunderland this Sunday with a perfect kickoff time in Thailand of 7 p.m. Questions. With Rodgers seemingly likely to go to Villa, do you think he's going to be a big miss to the borough team? Have a great day, guys. Take care. Up the borough from Bam. So I'll throw that one at Rye. Is he going to be a big miss? Would Rodgers
We'll give his idol Rye the chance to respond to that one.
It's interesting. It's a good question. And morning, Bam. I think it's for me. I did a bit of a depth chart with Borough fans on the X, and you know, got some good feedback to that
Twitter.
One.
But forget X.
Twitter.
Apologies. Yeah, thank you. And it was interesting to see what we all thought, because we actually are quite covered in that area, which I was surprising once you put the names down on a sheet of paper, how well we've got. So in that area, you've got obviously Izzy Jones, you've got Finn Azaz, the new signing, Sam Green was still online, you've got Riley McGree and Sammy Silvera to come back from international with Australia, and you've got Matty Crooks. You've also got Marcus Force that slides in and out of that area as well. So in terms of what I can see, I think we're actually well covered. Now, look, don't get me wrong. I think Rodgers has been a good talent. He's 6 months into a 4-year deal. Obviously, we saw something in him that, you know, now other teams are starting to see. The hardest thing for me with Rodgers is that he's a Midlands boy and he wants to go home, and I kind of understand that. And if you're going to get $15 million offered for him 6 months after you paid $1 million, you kind of want to take that, I think, and see how we go. Yeah, because I honestly don't think he's set worlds alight. I know, and I'm not trying to be disrespectful to him, I think he's a great player, but I put him next to, if you have a look at last season when we had Ryan Giles, Cameron Archer, Aaron Ramsey, right? Most of those boys, if they had been Borough players, what would have you asked for them? Do you know what I mean? Cameron Archer last season, where he'd scored 11 goals, how much would have he been worth? You know what I mean? Imagine having to sell him if he was a Borough player. Aaron Ramsey, the same question. Ryan Giles, the same question. Those players that were there setting the world alight for us last season have all gone to the Premier League and haven't done much this season. Cameron Archer hasn't really scored for Sheffield United. Aaron Ramsey's been injured, albeit all through the season. Ryan Giles has just been loaned back down to the Championship. Now, has Morgan Rodgers done better than those three for Borough this season? I'm going to be honest, and I don't think he has. I don't think he's been better than Cameron Archer. I don't think he's been better than Aaron Ramsey. I dare say I don't think he's been better than what Ryan Giles was doing last season. And all three of them have failed in the Premier League. So if he's going to go to the Premier League expecting to walk in and play for Aston Villa and we get 15 mil for it, that's a deal done in my books.
Cool. I'm not disagreeing. So let's move on.
Indeed. Well, we'll get the messy stuff out the way with, I think. And I don't mean the player that definitely shouldn't have had the Ballon d'Or.
No. Stop talking garbage. Get on with it. Lip up off the floor.
Crowd trouble, lads. Crowd trouble. No. Obviously, I don't know how many of you saw it, but the West Brom Wolves game was an absolute disgrace.
Wild.
I've not seen anything like that on my TV in probably the last 30 years maybe. But
crazy.
Steve, I mean, I'll come to you on this one first, a two-pronged thing. It just shows how well-policed and how well-behaved our fans were for a start-off.
Yes.
And how well-organised that whole thing was. And, you know, whatever will be said about 6,000 Geordies at the stadium alike will be said, and it'll get argued about forever and a day, but ultimately, fan behaviour was absolutely impeccable at the stadium, like from both sets of fans. That, though, yesterday, how on earth has it got to a stage where Wolves fans got in with West Brom fans?
It happens all the time at every game up and down the country. You know, people can get tickets for the home end. I mean, Fulham sold tickets at public sale because their fans were boycotting the ground because of the ticket prices for the FA Cup of the weekend. So, needless to say, there will have been Newcastle fans who live in London probably sitting in amongst home fans at the weekend. But it happens. Some families, I would imagine, you know, are Wolves and West Brom, and you know, somebody will have said, "I'm not going to that game." You know, yeah, you can have me ticket. It happens. It happens all the time. So, you could see yesterday, you know, that game the atmosphere. People were calling it a underestimated derby. You know, people say it's, you know, it's probably the most hatred in that one, you know, in the UK. Well, it certainly came across like that yesterday. The volume of the fans and the songs that were singing against each other as the teams entered the pitch, it was volatile. There's no other way to describe it. And ultimately, when a team scores, it's so difficult that you're sitting in the home end to sit on your hands, because it's emotion and, you know, it takes over, and that's that. And we saw some really unsavoury scenes yesterday. We saw kids coming out of the family enclosure. We saw one of the players actually lifting his own children out of the family enclosure because, you know, he was at risk. And we saw grown adults who should know better, acting in a ridiculous way. And look, the 70s and the 80s, this was part and parcel of our beautiful game, if you like. It was a true reflection on society, I guess, as well. You know, I mean, we're going through some horrendous times, in society, and people used to, you know, have 5 or 6 pints and go and have a fight at the football to relieve their frustrations and in the working class game. Whereas now we're past that, we're beyond that. And anybody misbehaving in a football ground, you're just setting yourself up for the biggest fall, you know, as a person, because you're going to lose your season ticket if you have one. You're going to be banned from football, and you know, probably for 3 years minimum, and you're going to have a criminal record. And you know, because everything now is on camera, and camera captures all of the movements, everything that's happened, can see who started what, and you know, you're just setting yourself up for a big fall. So I never understand why people do it. I really, really don't. And some of the stuff that's been circulated on social media is horrific. Some bizarre stuff as well. I mean, there was a middle-aged woman invading the pitch and attempting to kick a football was walked off, you know, much to the humour of the steward. But you know, it's just crazy. It really is. And West Brom will suffer. They won't have points deducted, but they'll have a big fine coming their way. They may have to play a game behind closed doors. You know, they will be punished in some way, shape, or form. But it's sad to see. Thankfully, it doesn't happen very often. But I've got to agree with you, Ted. You know, from our perspective, you know, it just shows that although it was an expensive process, and it felt, you know, over the top, it was the right thing to do with the Newcastle Sunderland game, because our derby was broadcast around the world, as was West Brom Wolves. And you know, we flew the flag for the North East, but flew the flag for the UK. You know, it showed that you can stage a volatile derby, a derby where there's a lot of animosity. You can stage it well without any trouble. And 5 or 6 arrests at ours for mainly people who couldn't handle a beer
outside the ground as well, wasn't
outside
it?
So outside the ground was
that outside was noise.
Oh, exactly. Yeah, but it was sad. It was sad to see. And I mean, you know, spontaneous reactions like that at football matches, which then, like the blue touch paper, are few and far between. Thankfully, it's not something we see on a regular basis at football matches in stadiums. I think that's what makes it horrific. It still goes on. Football hooliganism still goes on. Various firms still meet pre-match at various places, bars, pubs, waste ground, you name it. They still do it. I'm afraid the problem hasn't gone away, but usually it's not inside the ground, thankfully. That's, nobody should go to a football match to go and watch a football game and end up hurt. And you know, the worst thing about yesterday was seeing somebody being, you know, taken away on a stretcher. And let's just hope that person is okay. You know,
it all went a bit mental. Right, Dave, we'll bring you on this one as well. I mean, for one, I think personally, I think the club, West Brom, should be held accountable. If they know that derby is as volatile as they claim it is, and if they want to build it up to be a big derby, then that's fine. That's up to them. But surely more care needs to be taken with the ticketing side of things, and make sure with the people who are, they say they are. But secondly as well, I mean, we saw the thing with the Maidenhead fan coming over the top and landing on top of Ipswich supporters. You know, it was all hijinks and getting carried away, but we're getting to a stage now where safety is becoming more and more of a concern. Would you agree?
Yeah, I would agree. I think what's crazy for me as well is we saw, and I'll talk to Dave obviously after this, about the the Port Vale game where we saw a referee getting chased, for goodness sake. I mean, it was a wild weekend, but it was, for me, it drives that media narrative story even more. We saw in the media with the Newcastle Sunderland game and leading up to that how much media can drive a story. Now, we saw that there's going to be hooliganism, there's going to be fights, there's going to be flares, there's going to be knives, there's going to be everything, you know, threatened. And that was all driven by newspapers and media outlets coming up to your game. Now, I would argue last week, none of us really knew or focused on West Brom versus Wolves. None of us did.
No.
You know, no, we didn't really talk about it. I was like, oh, wow, they actually played against each other. Nobody spoke about it and nobody drove this football hooliganism story, and yet it broke out like it did. You know what I mean? And it was poorly sort of managed by West Brom's behalf. So it was interesting to see, just to drive that narrative home of how much that, you know, the media played into your game rather than, you know, and this game where you saw an actual, you know, and something happened. So
yeah.
Yeah, look, it's solely on West Brom here. They've got a hard look at their ticket office, how it happened. I mean, it's hard to combat, you know, like Steve said, someone can give a ticket away, you know, if you're a West Brom fan and you're a Wolves fan.
But if ID checks are carried out right, then surely that negates that.
Can you ID check though 30,000 home fans?
It'd be a hard job. Yeah. I agree, it's a hard job, but I think it was definitely sad to see. It was Green Street hooligans, sort of movie stuff that, and it was definitely scary to see. And some of the scenes we've seen on Twitter was, you know, with the amount of that poor bloke with, you know, which you thought was a bat, you know what I mean, like that was, you know, he's just gone out. Maybe he was looking for trouble. We don't know the full story, but nobody wants to come away from a football match looking like that.
Yeah, I mean, the thing that surprised me was if the two clubs knew, particularly West Brom, being the hosts, knew that this was such a highly charged game and that the atmosphere could turn nasty so quickly, why did they have so few stewards stopping West Brom fans in that corner where all the trouble was? So few stewards stopping the fans from getting over the barrier and onto the pitch side, because that's what caused a lot of this. Yes, they had the steward segregating. There wasn't a big... I look at the Riverside and, you know, we take a section out and stick netting over it to stop rival fans getting to each other. This was a row of stewards standing on the stairway separating two sets of fans. I mean, they were that close together. Now, I'm all for football clubs making money, fellas, and selling as many tickets as you can. But if you're going to go into a Celtic Rangers, a Newcastle Sunderland... whatever it happens to be, type derby like West Brom Wolves, and all you're going to do is stick a row of orange jackets between two sets of fans, you're almost inviting trouble. You really are.
Yeah.
It's a great point.
No, it wasn't well handled. And there wasn't enough stewards towards for that game for what it was. Do you know what I mean? It was a packed out stadium. It was obviously a derby that they, you know, fans were focusing about. Maybe it was spoken about more in that area, but it definitely wasn't on news.
I once went to a Forest Derby game. Now, that's not pleasant. They hate each other, Forest and Derby. Yeah, it was at Derby County. It was at Pride Park, long before the Mel Morris problems came in. So that was a packed stadium, a full stadium. And the fans hated each other. But it was very much like that Sunderland-Newcastle Derby that we saw in the Cup, where, you know, the fans goaded each other, they had their fun, it was vitriol that was flying backwards and forwards, but never the two met, and never was there any problems like this. So you've got to point the finger at West Brom and say, what happened, guys?
Yeah, agreed. Definitely needs to be looked into further, and it needs to be looked at why there wasn't more stewards on the day, and anyone that was hurt. But Dave, can I ask you, obviously, that Port Vale game, seeing a referee chase, as a referee, former referee yourself, I thought that was disgraceful. I mean, that poor bloke ran for his, you know, you don't know what that fan was going to do.
That's
you can
exactly,
all guess, you can speculate.
Was he carrying a knife? But who knows?
Exactly, you don't know. But for a fan to be able to get on that pitch and get as close to that referee as he did, I think is a scary sort of reminder that we need to, you know, we do need to look at that.
I've seen, this similar things have happened several times, sadly. But you always seem to find players intervening, stopping the fan before he gets to his intended target. On that one, the players just seem to stand there and watch and not get involved. You know, maybe they're thinking exactly the same as what we're speculating. Exactly. What is he carrying? What's his intent here? You know, I don't know.
Well, worried, the coaches
had to stop him.
Oh, the response was the worst thing.
There was absolutely... I mean, there was... right, fair enough. It's like sort of, I don't know, a dog getting on the pitch and chasing a referee. All right, a little bit of comedy moment there. Like, all right, mild threat, I think the film classification would call it. But that was dangerous. That was a genuine, could have been a genuine threat to life, threat to well-being, anything like that. And some of the comments of, like, almost encouraging that kind of behaviour.
Yeah.
That's not what referees need.
But not just that.
I mean, because it only takes some idiot in the park, you know, in a Sunday league game to copy the same, where there's not as much protection for a referee, and you've got a police case on your hands.
Yeah, I've been clipped.
Problem is, somebody could be armed, you know, somebody could be carrying a knife. It's only a matter of time before something happens.
But I've got to ask, where were the stewards? Because that lad ran from the far side of the pitch. So there was plenty of time to see him coming across. You tend to have a lot of safety stewards in and around the tunnel area, which is where the referee ran to. Where were the stewards to get in front of even the coaches who had to stop him?
Problem is, stewards are on they're on less than minimum wage. Some of these people aren't they? They're on like peanuts. They're on peanuts, and they're not paid to get involved in jumping on top of somebody the rules and regs for a steward within somewhere are probably to help somebody get to their seat, help somebody with directions, with tickets, etc. And I think they just don't see it as their job. It's probably in the job description to stop somebody jumping onto the pitch. But, you know, some people just think, well, I'm not going to do it. And most of these people, you know, without getting into like a row with someone about, you know, the size of somebody or, you know, the fact that maybe they're not the fittest people, they're not, these people aren't, you know, the genuine, a lot of these stewards tend not to be, they're not doorman types, for example. You know, they're not there for, they're not there for a row. They're there just to manage crowds, and that's the problem. They don't want to get involved. They don't want conflict, and that's the issue that you have, you know, and
the biggest disappointment out of all of this for me, though, was the reaction on social media. So we've seen the Benny Hill music added to this clip and all that sort of stuff to have a good laugh. Yeah. But some of the comments that people are posting, they really need to give their heads a big shake. You know, I feel like I'm going to do that next time Anthony Taylor referees us because he has it in for us and all that sort of stuff that's coming out.
Yeah,
I mean, it's just ridiculous. Yeah. There's some mindless idiots out there who look at a situation like this and they just want to throw fuel onto the flames. That's all they want to do.
It was someone's dad running away from an attacker. You know what I mean? It was someone's dad, someone's brother, someone's son. You know what I mean? It's a bit more than just a referee. You know what I mean? That is someone's family running away from someone that is chasing them on a football pitch, and no one stepped in except for the coaches. And he got halfway across the pitch. Now, if that's my son, if that's my dad, whatever it is, you know, I'm sitting there probably in the stands watching my dad referee a game. Do you know what I mean? At that level. You know what I mean? Can you imagine if he was... Well, imagine if his kid was in the sideline watching your dad get chased by a fan. Like, that is disgusting.
Yeah. Is there any of us on here?
Never happen.
Is there any of us on here? If you had those boots on and you were one of those players and you were close to him, would any of us 100%. Try to stop him? Would you try to trip him up, do all that sort of stuff?
I would have given him the biggest Australian shoulder barge, mate. I would have jumped on... Yeah, 100%. Have you seen Andrew Simons? Does anyone know who I'm talking about then? Andrew Simons was a famous cricketer for Australia. He sadly passed away a couple of years ago, but there was exactly this happened in an Australian cricket pitch about 4 or 5 years ago now. An invader ran on and he was running exactly for the referee, he was running for the players, and he gave him the biggest shoulder barge you've ever seen in your life, sent him about 3 metres backwards. I would have done exactly the same thing. I would have literally just, you have to. It's when you saw who he was targeting, especially when you saw the referee running away in you know, scared, 100%. It was on one of those players to jump in, not the coaches. And that was soft from the players.
Yeah. There you go.
Anyway, we're done and dusted, fellas.
We are.
Good stuff, chaps. Well done, Ted. You got through it. I will be back on Wednesday, day off tomorrow.
You will be.
London early doors, lads. So have a good one tomorrow.
Enjoy, mate. Have a safe trip.
I will send in some headlines, lads.
You're not moving, are you?
No worries.
No, not moving, mate. I'm not moving.
Have a good one, fellas.
See you
later.
Have
a good one. Have a great day.
Cheers.
Goodbye.
Ta-ra.
From Yarm to Yibby, Harrington to Horsley Hill, Swalwell to Silverlink, the North East Footy Breakfast with Rye, Steve and Ted.
Right across the North East, the Red Platoon and the Cat.